the weirdness that's in the world that most people tend to ignore. And I like collecting those stories and then sharing them with people and scaring people around Halloween. I've always liked these stories, you know, from the time I was a little kid and, you know, watching Unsolved Mysteries on TV.
A knock on the door, that's how most stories begin, because most stories are about the search for truth in one way or another.
You know, the true crime stuff I did for about 7-8 years, and, you know, it wears on you after a while. You know, all that tragedy and darkness of the fact that it's all true. So I wanted to take, you know, the tools and tricks that I learned as a true crime writer and do something a little more fun with them. So, you know, that's why I started collecting these spooky stories from around Ohio. And that's why I write mystery novels now, so that I can write about mysteries that I can actually solve for once. Well, I was doing a lot of library talks on the true crime books, and people started coming up to me afterwards, and they would tell me some weird ghost story or some encounter with Bigfoot, or they'd ask me if I'd ever heard of the Loveland Frog.
The first modern-day sighting of what has come to be called the Loveland Frog was in 1955, 17 years before Shockey's encounter. They described them as humanoid, with wrinkles instead of hair, and big gaping mouths like frogs.
Then I found this story about the Tweetwe Indians that used to live in that region in the 1600s. When they first encountered French men, the Tweetwe people warned the Frenchmen that there was this demon that lived in the river called the Shanahook. And the Indians told them, it looks kind of like a man and kind of like a frog. Like, I don't know how to explain that. I guess because I'm a reporter, people seem to think they could share these stories with me that they've never really shared with anybody else outside their family. And then I decided to go after these stories of monsters and things that go bump in the night and UFOs the same way I'd go about reporting any true crime story, which is to find the nugget of truth in there and then go outwards. So, you know, I attacked like an investigative reporter, even the silly story about the Loch Ness monster that lives in Lake Erie.